Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. And neither are we affiliated with a church or religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of the eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating through our Trinity unto this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kenley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we're incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Now, since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States, Canada, and some foreign other countries. Now, the Ontario Branch School was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we use to teach by the true and originated titles for the Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. Now, the true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It's been properly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lord's many in God's many. We now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for Himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Now, Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, He's incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized on this chart in His pure spirit state as a cloud. Now, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Now, we draw this fiery cloud all around the edge of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word of Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now, this shape and form could only be seen in a divine vision and understood in divine revelation. Later on, the self-same Spirit manifests Himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah. The world calls Him Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So simple, yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? Now, a further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also, this book we teach Elohim, the archetype original pattern of the universe. Now, it is called a pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. Now, after Yahweh led the children of Israel up out of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. Now, he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. Now, this pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. Also, in this book, we go forth to prove that everything in the universe moves and operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Now, the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this two are as follows. Okay. Number one is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as it really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without the distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning, ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life right now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our watchers, peace. Our slogan, speak the truth. Okay, this morning we'll have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. Our scripture lesson is Exodus 24 chapters. Our scripture reader will be Dr. Eunice Reister. What did you want to do?
It's okay. Are you from this?
No, go ahead.
Something wrong with it. There's no,
nothing. I saw that one.
It's on, yeah. Go ahead. Yeah,
music
after the prayer.
Oh, yeah, okay. Good morning, class.
Good morning.
This is a time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, creator of this stellar universe, the things seen and unseen, to things known and not known. Thank you for giving us an opportunity to come and assemble with the faith to learn about your purpose and your plan of salvation for mankind in these last days. I say the last days because whoever ends his life is the last day for him. And there is opportunity for everyone on earth to know a about your purpose and your plan. It's about life and death, believe it or not. I say all those things, and you only sang in the Shadow Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
Scripture lesson will be taken from the 24th chapter of Exodus, and I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trina, Scripture Research Association Incorporated. Exodus, the 24th chapter, page 99. And he said unto Moses, Come up unto Yahweh, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship ye afar off. And Moses alone shall come near Yahweh, but they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with him. And Moses came and told the people all the words of Yahweh, and all the judgments. And all the people answered with one voice, and said, all the words which Yahweh has said, we will do. And Moses wrote all the words of Yahweh, and rose up early in the morning, and built an altar under the hill, and 12 pillars, according to the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sent young men of the children of Israel, which offer burnt offerings, and sacrifice peace offerings of oxen unto Yahweh. And Moses took half of the blood, and put it in basins, and half of the blood he sprinkled on the altar. And he took the book of the covenant, and read in the audience of the people. And they said, all that Yahweh has said will we do, and be obedient. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant which Yahweh has made will ye concern with you concerning all these words. Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. And they saw the Elohim of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone, and as it were the body of heaven in its clearness. And upon the noble of the children of Israel he laid not his hand. Also they saw Elohim, and did eat and drink. And Yahweh said unto Moses, come up to me into the mount, and be there, and I will give thee tables of stone, and a law and commandment which I have written, that thou mayest teach them. And Moses rose up, and his minister Joshua. And Moses went up into the mount of Elohim. And he said unto the elders, tarry ye here for us, until we come again unto you. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. If any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them. And Moses went up into the mount, and a cloud covered the mount. And the glory of Yahweh abode upon the Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud. And the sight of the glory of Yahweh was like devouring fire on the top of the mount in the eyes of the children of Israel. And Moses went into the midst of the cloud, and got him up into the mount. And Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. And I have read the 24th chapter of Exodus. Let us all say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you. And good to see everybody here today. Our first speaker today would be the Dean of the Infantry Veterans School, Dr. Joe Williams.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
It's a pleasure and an honor to stand up before you and to testify of some of the things that Yahweh allowed me to see and understand about this great teaching. I'm not sure what happened to everybody today, but anyway, wherever there's two or three gathered, you follow me, Yahweh's always in the midst. And this is one of the things we're talking about, the business meeting about. This might be one of those days we can get into something. However, I want to go on to some of the things that I was into Thursday night. I'm not going to take the whole time, but I'm going to get into something about what was into Thursday night. And that is, I want to take a trip up in that garden. Now, I want to lay a brief foundation before I do that, and that is this. I want to get in some of the basic fundamental principles of this school. Now, before saying that, I want to encourage everybody in the class, and I mean everyone that's in the class, that we try to make, as a class, go and visit the go to the November 2019 function or symposium they're going to have in New Mexico, Albuquerque, New Mexico. But I just don't want to select you. I would love to see us all go. If we start preparing now, whether it be by train, or whether by plane, whether by car, I think we all can make that collectively as a class to make that, you know. And so I think the registration is going to be up, and I just want to encourage us to do that. And we're going to be making this announcement on a regular basis to keep this on folks' minds so we can make it. If you prepare for it a year and a half in advance, I think we all make it and support that particular symposium. Now, let me have real quickly, 1 Colossians, I believe is 3 and 20. Okay?
Corinthians or Colossians?
Colossians.
There's only one.
I apologize. Did I say first? Colossians.
Okay.
Colossians 3 and 20.
Colossians 3 and 20.
Colossians 3 and 20. Now listen, this is the Apostle Paul speaking in this age, the present kingdom age, right where we sit. As it says in prayer, this is the last day and this is the end right now. Let's see. And Paul is looking all the way back. You see, back in Rome eternity, and he's bringing those principles all up today and showing what Yahweh was talking about, you see, to back in the law and the prophets. And this is one of the things he said. Read.
Colossians 3 and 20. Children, obey your parents in all things.
I apologize. I want Philippians. Philippians 3 and 20, where it says, our citizenship or our conversation is in heaven. That's what I was looking for. I apologize.
Philippians 3 and
20. Yeah, that's it right there.
For our citizenship is in heaven.
Now, our citizenship is in heaven, whereas in Holy Name, it says our conversation is in heaven. They're both comfortable, or true. Read,
please. Holy Name.
Go ahead.
For our citizenship is in heaven.
Read.
From whence also we are expecting our Savior King, Yahshua the Messiah.
Read.
Who shall change our vile body.
Who shall change our vile body. Now listen, when she made that statement, this is after Yahshua's death, burial, resurrection, and ascension of and outpouring of the Holy Spirit. You see? But so the question is, where is he coming from? And where is he now? Mm-hmm. Let's read, please.
Who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself.
Now, are he going to change our vile bodies, right, into his glorious body, right? Mm-hmm. Now, let's just get one thing understood. He's not talking about this outer man. Although we would love for it to change. It's something magnificent and glorious. But counter, you head straight to the dirt. So the glorious body that he's talking about is you as a man, what you become is going to change this vile body of corruption. You see, with a plethora of theories, concepts, and opinions, you see, which are not absolute, into this glorious body, you see, that is of Yahshua Messiah or Yahweh Elohim himself. That's what we're going to be changed into. And I'm telling you this right now, that can happen right now. To have eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah with the hope of reward of glorification in the new earth thing. That can happen right now today. Okay? Changing that vile body, you see, which is in reality this thing you call a you. That's what I'm talking about. You see, you don't want no parts of it. Yahweh don't want no parts of it. If you are comfortable and happy this way, you might as well make an exodus out of this room because you have no business up in here.
That's right.
Because we're trying to change this vile body into this glorious body. This is what I'm talking about when I'm talking about you. Your carnality, your mind subject to change, your morals changing because as the world changed, and you know that your body is temporal, you see, your heart and your mind and your soul is corrupt. You see, mortality is nothing more than quantified immortality. That's all that is. And you're corrupt with theories, concepts, and opinions. That's it. And at the end of the day, that leads you to eternal damnation.
All right? Now, let's read Ephesians 2 and 1. Let's read quickly, please. I need you to pick up, one of y'all pick up Romans 5 and 17. I mean 5 and 12.
Ephesians 2 and 1.
Uh-huh.
And you had he quickened.
Now you look. You, everybody in the room, has he quickened. Now who he's quickened is the sons. Those who knew and those who understand. What I mean by that is this. Paul was talking to people in Ephesus who he had left there to teach the people. You see? Same thing in Rome and same thing in Corinth. You follow me? There were the people who knew. Brethren. Mm-hmm. People who knew. He wasn't talking to all the doggone Corinthians like that. He was talking to ones who knew. And ye have he quickened. Read.
Who were dead in trespasses and sins.
Now listen, these Jews, they were dead psychologically and spiritually so. Meaning this, they was corrupt by these carnal ordinances. In what respect? They thought that if they can keep the 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances, you see, that they would be saved. That's what they thought. To the point that folks, to this day, drag those principles on this side of the cross, and they still think they can hold up, you see, and maintain that law, and they will be saved in this law. Mm. To the point is, they actually believe a lie. Now, we talked about this Friday night.
Thursday.
Apologize. Thursday night. And that is this. There's a difference between an illusion. An illusion and a delusion.
Ends look like W's, I'm not sure why.
But anyway, there's a difference between an illusion and a delusion. And what we talked about was this, that an illusion is a misconception of reality. That's what the definition of an illusion is. You see? And an example of that would be a magician who saw the woman in half and her legs waving and she's laughing and talking. You follow me? It's an illusion, it's a trick. A magic trick. However, once you find out how he performed the trick, mm-hmm. you follow what I'm saying? Then you've just taken off the flesh. You understand the reality of the trick or the illusion that has been presented to you. Right. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. But then there is a delusion. And we talked about how that. That's what I write.
Yes.
Pseudo-sciesis. Pseudo-sciesis is the medical term we use for women who think they're pregnant to the point that they manifest all the symptoms of pregnancy because they want to be pregnant so bad to the point that they develop symptoms of pregnancy, the test is positive, the breast begins to enlarge, they begin to develop milk where they can lactate, the belly getting on out there, and this can go on for all, sometimes 8, 9, 10, a whole 9 months sometimes. But the point I'm trying to make, they believe it's so hard in their heart and their mind, it becomes a reality to them. Do you understand? There's only one problem, ain't no fetus.
Right.
There is no fetus. You see, when you look at a sonogram, there is no baby being developed in the womb. Mm-hmm. However, that person still believes that she is pregnant.
Right.
That is a delusion. You with me so far? Mm-hmm. Then the folks come into the school, and we show in the moderation and in the scriptures and in the encyclopedia and the dictionary that Jesus is not the name, you see, of that man that was on the cross. That the true name of the Son or the Holy Spirit is Yahshua, which means Yahweh is salvation. Shua means salvation. You see, but it's Yahweh, it's salvation. And it was in fact Yahweh in that body as Yahshua the Messiah. You see, but there is not a Yahweh and a Yahshua as a separate entity, but it is Yahweh in that body as Yahshua the Messiah, who is the Savior. You understand what I'm saying? Nevertheless, what we want you to understand that we say that this name here is a combination of a Greek sky god, Zeus, and a Babylonian deity, which is it, that makes up that name, and that Christ, you see, comes from Christian, which means the anointed one. However, my point is that there is no J in the Hebrew language, you see, to this day, or the Latin, or the Greek. Nevertheless, folks want to hold on to Jesus, you see, with their life and guard their life, and as a matter of fact, may even die for it. However, there was no J in any language prior to the Middle Ages. Nevertheless, they were to hold on to Jesus, which is a lie. And that is a delusion.
Yep.
All right? Now, with that being said, go back to Ephesians. Let's read, please.
2. Wherein time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air.
Now, the prince of the power and of the in the air, that is Lucifer. That's exactly who that is. You see, read on, please.
Spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience.
Read on.
Among whom also we all had our deportment in time past in the lust of our flesh.
Now, deportment just simply means our behavior. That's all it's saying. In other words, we all have fault. I'd be nice.
Huh.
We all have fault. We all have done things we don't like, we're not pleased with, or we got skeletons. But let's read on, please.
In the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh.
Fulfilling the desires of your carnal mind. All right?
Mm-hmm.
Not the physical body, but your carnal mind. That's all we're doing, is satisfying our flesh. In other words, if it was the physical body that was doing these things, then all these folks in the graveyard, they might as well just enjoy themselves. But it's what you entertain here that's causing the problem. And I'm letting you know, that is, in reality, your flesh that you call a you. And I'm letting you know, Yahweh is not saving your carnality. He's only saving, you see, you from yourself. To get you to see that in reality, you are Yahweh in the personality of whoever you call yourself. Whether it be Jack, Joe, John, Bob, that's who you are. That's the reality. And it is through the Holy Spirit that those principles are revealed. So it takes perfection. Because 7 denotes perfection, because there are 7 steps in this pattern, you see. There are 7 days of creation, there are 7 dispensations. Did you understand what I'm saying? And 7 denotes perfection. So it takes perfection to point out imperfection. That's what's happening here. Let's read, please.
Fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind.
Uh-huh.
And were by nature the children of wrath, even as others.
Go ahead.
But Yahweh, who is rich in mercy,
read.
For his great love, wherewith he loved us,
read.
Even when we were dead in our sins,
read.
Has quickened us together with the Messiah.
Now listen, even though we were dead, you see, by holding on to the carnal artifices, or what we think, or what we believe, or what we think, or what we feel, theories, concepts, and opinions, because at the end of the day, this law ain't never saved anybody. And never will save anybody. If it did, it don't make sense for him to get up on that cross. But grace has been dispensed, that is, in this present kingdom age, which we are all recipients of. Let's read, please.
By grace ye are saved.
By grace are ye saved. Not by the law, but by his grace and his mercy, we all are saved, you see, through his death, his burial, and his resurrection. You see, and the outpouring and the dispensing of the Holy Spirit in this present kingdom age. You see, on the day of Pentecost. And the day of Pentecost is still going on, and we are living in that day. You see, and we're trying to get you into the body. Not this one here hanging on the cross of Yahshua Messiah. Not this one, but in the body of Yahshua Messiah, whereby it is him and only him that is reigning in that body, and that is immortality personified. That is, if you will. Y'all with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
Now, Romans 5:12. Let's talk about how we got that way.
Romans 5:12.
Let's talk about just how we got that way. You see, now, here's Paul. He's speaking to us in this present kingdom age. You see? And he's trying to educate us what went on way back in around eternity, what went on back in that garden, and why we behaving and acting the way that we do. What Paul also did while he was explaining these principles, he was pointing out the beast man of sin. And please, don't be afraid of him. He ain't no problem. As a matter of fact, without him, you would never understand about Yahweh.
That's right.
We have an imagination that we create about what Yahweh looked like. And I'll give you an example. Somebody say, are you a believer? Do you know God? Do you know Jesus? My question is, do you? Tell me about him. Then they start with the talking points. Explain the talking points. They go back to another talking point. But they never get into any substance. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's the substance that we're interested in. Something that can free us and liberate us from the flesh. That's what I'm talking about. The reality of the teaching is realizing, you see, is that Yahshua Messiah has been with you all along. But he's been here because you're still under a delusion looking for God someplace other than within you. That's the point that I'm making. You see? Now, here's Paul. This is what he said. Read Romans 5:12.
Romans 5:12.
Let's read.
Wherefore, by one man, sin entered into the world.
Now, by one man, sin entered into the world. Read on.
And death by sin.
Talking about Adam. That's what he's talking about, the man Adam. I will take plates number 11 and 12. I'll use this for 15. And while you're at it, oh, she's been nice. I'll even take place number 1 and 2, since everybody being so zealous and helping out today. And I probably should have brought my plate 14 while I was there. Yeah. I think I will take that in a minute. Take him. Thank you so much. I appreciate it ever so much. You're so kind. All right. I probably should have put that towards this way. You know right now? For
well,
the over? Okay. I didn't play 15.
That's 15, so you need 11 and 12 before
okay.
It.
Okay. We should do it this way. We'll do it like that. Better for the camera shot, I guess. And we'll put 14 right next to it. All right. See, I have a tendency to talk too doggone much. And next thing I know, what I want to really talk about, I don't get to. But today, I say, well, that's that up today, since he called me. I ain't tall. All right, let's go. Go ahead.
And so death passed upon all men, for all that all have sinned.
So death passed upon all men,
for
and
that
all
have sinned.
Have sinned. All means all. Not some of us. All means all. Alright? And he's talking about this man, Adam. Alright? Let's read.
For until the law, sin was in the world.
Now until the law. Alright, I'm talking about the Mosaic law. Sin was already in the world. Read.
But sin is not imputed.
But sin is not imputed. In other words, you're not guilty. You're not accountable when there is no law. In other words, we do stuff, we ain't got no business. But you know what? Nobody get punished. We run the red light. You see? Well, it's right, let's say stop sign. Stop sign. They've probably already been up, but hey, you ran stop sign. Now we got a fine for you because you don't get it, so we're gonna hit you where it hurts, you hit your pocketbook. Because we have a tendency you see, to value that more than ourselves sometimes. Put, you know, you're driving, reckless driving, or you're drunk driving, you got kids, you follow what I'm saying? That's what I'm saying. Let's read.
Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses.
Now look, death, I'll go over here. Death reigned from Adam down to Moses. Understand, we're talking about the dispensation of Moses. And I'll explain that real quick so I can move on. I don't want to spend too much time on this. I want to make a point. I ain't going to go through all of them. We know that after the fall of Adam, he lived for 930 years. We know that. And he died. You see, 70 years short, that is, of one day. One day with Yahweh is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as one day. All right? However, the dispensation of Adam, even though he died, was still going on until Yahweh talked to Noah. And we know that Yahweh appeared to Noah when he was 480 years old, and that he preached 120 years old. And the year of the flood, he was 600 years old. Y'all with me so far? So, the year of the flood...
Erase that zero. You got 6,000.
I apologize. The year of the flood, he was 600 years old. Okay. However, you see it right here on this chart. We got it right here. 2348, that is the year of the flood. You follow what I'm saying? Counting from 4,004, you see, minus 1,656, what we got right here on the chart, which is going to give you 2348. Y'all with me so far? That's the year of the flood. That's what this number represents. Now, but the dispensation of Noah was still going on during the year of the flood. Now, when the flood did come, you see, it was Yahweh who shut the door, not Noah. Although folks say that Noah shut the door. Nobody can prove that. But we know for a fact that Yahweh shut the door. I believe it was Revelations, is it 8:12? I think that's what I want.
Revelations 8:12.
I think that's what I want.
And the fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten.
Revelations 3:8.
Is it 3:8? You double check that, make sure. I think you're right.
3:8.
I know that's exactly where it is.
I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door.
Read.
And no man can shut it.
Read.
For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name.
Read.
Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews, and are...
About the door?
Yeah. Okay, I heard that part, but I thought there was something off. Maybe we should have started the one up before and then read down to that one. Which started,
Into the messenger?
Read seven.
Seven. And to the messenger of the assembly in Philadelphia write.
Read.
These things saith he that is holy.
Read.
He that is true. He that hath the key of David.
Read.
He that openeth and no man shutteth.
Uh-huh.
And shutteth and no man openeth.
In other words, can't nobody open the door? And can't nobody shut the door save Yahshua the Messiah himself. That's the point I'm making. And listen, John is looking back at this event. Because he's way on this side of the cross, and he's telling you what's happening back then. You with me so far? Let's read, please.
Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie.
That's good enough right there. Now, my point is, Noah came, moved from, listen, death unto life. All those who were in the ark, you see, were saved. And let's just get this straight and understood. Yahweh was not saving the people. You guys know how y'all have ants going up?
Right.
You follow me? And they go down this way, and they go down the head. You get the point? That's how Yahweh feel about you. He'll take you know that spray? And you know how we do sometimes. We do this here. And they go all over the place, right? That's what they do. Or you take that spray. He wasn't saving the people. Yahweh was saving the ark. Why? because the ark was the ark of safety. And if you was obedient and you believe the report, that it had not yet rained at that particular time, that it was going to rain, because these people never seen a rain. If you got the ark, then you were saved. If you was out of the ark, then of course you died, because the ark itself was a type of immortality. It was beyond the possibility of death. You see, in fulfillment, Yahshua the Messiah, he is our ark, and we have to be in him. You see, and if you're not in him, then you are psychologically and spiritually dead. But if you are in him, you have life. That is in Yahshua the Messiah. So that's why I make the point that he wasn't saving the people, he was saving the ark. You see, and everything outside the ark died, and it was dead. Nevertheless, Noah was going to move from death unto life. That is in the post-diluvian age. And when they came out of the ark, that is in a new age. However, the dispensation of Noah was still going on. Remember, death reigned from Adam on down to Moses. Now, and listen, Noah lived 350 years on this side of the flood, which makes him 950 years old when he died. You see, which is the same thing here as 3.5 years, pointing to Yahshua the Messiah. Mm-hmm. Then Yahweh spoke to Abraham. Okay, that's spell that right, Nikki Wayne? Mm-hmm. That's close enough. He lived to be 175 years old, and he died. Okay? And the dispensation of Abraham was still going on. However, until he spoke to Moses. And when he spoke to Moses, Moses was 40 years, that is, in Egypt. He was 40 years, you see, in the wilderness. He went back down to Egypt to liberate the people from bondage. And then he spent another 40 years, that is, in the wilderness. Y'all with me so far?
Yes.
That makes him 120 years old. Now, the book says death reigned from Adam down to Moses. Not the man Moses, but the dispensation of Moses. Because Moses lived to be 120 years old, and he died. All right? But the dispensation of Moses ended at the cross. So therefore, death reigned from Adam, from the fall of Adam, all the way down to the cross. You see? And after the cross, you see, he resurrected in 3 days. He tarried on earth for 40 days. He ascended to the Father. 10 days later, he poured his spirits out in the hearts of modern men. And that was where the dispensational change took place. That is, after the 50 days. After the, technically 53. He died, buried, resurrected, and then 50 days later he poured his spirit out in the hearts of mighty men, and that's when the dispensational change took place. So death reigned from Adam on down to Moses. That's what he's talking about. So therefore, those folks, from the fall of Adam all the way down to the cross, they were in bondage. They were in darkness. And those are the folks that need to be saved. You see, and for those folks who did not believe, and let me tell you this, I don't care what they want, they can pray all they want. I'm talking about these folks from Adam all the way down. It was not going to be until the day of Pentecost took place. Then and only then, they can be recipients of the promise that was given to Abraham, that in his seed he's going to bless all the family of the nation, both Jew and Gentile. And that promise was fulfilled, that is, on the day of Pentecost. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam all the way down to Moses. Read. Don't be scared now.
Are we still in Revelations?
Death reigned from Adam all the way down to Moses. That's what we're talking about. We use Revelations to show that Yahweh shut the door, you see, and he opened the door. But when folks say that Noah shut the door, I'm saying reproved or rebuked by the scriptures what's being said. What we're talking about you see, is going back to showing forth the origin of how the man dies psychologically and spiritually. So we're back in Romans. Mm-hmm. Y'all with me? Just start again. 5 and 12.
Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed where there is no law.
Nevertheless,
death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression.
Now hold it. So now, even those who have not sinned after Adam's transgression. So when they put him on the cross, they had to put a crown of thorns on his head. You follow me? Because they had to be, the angel had to be atoned too. Because without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin, right? So they had to put a crown of thorns on the head, on Yahshua's head. Because he had to sustain the angels. And then he had to get nailed in his hand because we were not yet born. You see, and even those on this side of the cross had to also be redeemed. So he nailed him in his hand here. And then, of course, those from the fall of Adam all the way down the cross, he had to get them too. Mm-hmm. And listen, he had to sustain, you see, those folks from the fall from the law. My God, dog. He had to get, you know, the book says he preached to the captives and he set the captives free.
Right.
And some folks believe, you see, that there was folks buried like your parents, and then they resurrected, and all of a sudden, that's not what he's talking. This is the principle of the sons. All those sons that was in darkness from Adam all the way down had to be set free. Mm-hmm. And there was no Holy Spirit that was poured out and that was remained in a man, save Yahshua the Messiah. That's how John was able to point him out. The Holy Spirit was always prevalent. You see, but it did not get into a man and remain, or he was conscious of it because Yahweh would use him as you could pick up a pen.
Right.
So those are the captives who need to be set free. Were those folks who was in darkness from Adam all the way down to the cross. You with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's head back over to Egypt, head over back to Exodus 24th chapter, the scripture lesson, so I can get this out. Now, the only reason we know anything about the origin of creation is for one reason and one reason only. Yahweh called Moses up in the mount. You see, blacked him out and showed him a rerun of how the creation came in by the pattern. And what he showed him, you see, I said rerun. The creation was already here. How do I know that? Moses wrote the vision. He was familiar with water. He was familiar with the animals. He was familiar with the man. But what he did not know is the origin of the man and the origin of the creation. That he was not familiar with. He was just like you and I. He was just living and enjoying himself and doing the best he can. Nevertheless, Yahweh summons him, that is, out of the land of Egypt. You see, when he killed that man and buried him in the sand. You see, he come out here in the wilderness, he's out there for 40 years, we talked about a minute ago, but he also was commissioned to go back down to the land of Egypt to liberate the children of Israel, because they were in bondage, you see, and they were in darkness, you see, and let me say this, there was nothing righteous in those folks down there in the land of Egypt. You see, Yahweh wanted to bring them up out of here, so he sent Moses as a front man, but we tell you all the time, it was Joshua the son of Nun who was running the show. You see, the whole time orchestrating the whole purpose and plan of Yahweh, that is, as he himself was manifested in the flesh. And he directed Moses and instructed Moses on what to do, how to do, when to do, you see, carrying out the purpose and plan of Yahweh, that is, from start to finish. So therefore, you see, they had to take out a lamb, you see, because, see, it pointed to the true lamb, which was Yahshua the Messiah himself, or Yahweh himself. This is the lamb's plan before the foundation of the world. Don't miss this part. If you don't understand something down here, look up here. Because what's declared in heaven is made manifest on earth. Everything you see in the 7 days of creation is laid down, you see, that is in the migratory pattern down here. And I'll give you a quick example.
We talked about there's a 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, a 60, and a 70. We'll take it real easy. You know, there was a 3-day journey to the Red Sea, right? Mm-hmm. And then that would be light to the 30, right? Mm-hmm. And then the children of Israel, I mean, the Red Sea tunneled up, right? So what are you talking about? And then they went through on dry land. Well, that points to the fourth step or the 40, right? Or the door. So you have to see Yahweh Elohim. What did I do with it? Oh, I left it back here. You got to see Yahweh Elohim as, you see, the son that's making an exodus coming from behind the veil of inscrutability and incomprehensibility appearing in a cloud, which is likened to him coming through a door. However, this is a chaotic state condition, you see, which is likened to the chaos and the chaotic state that was going on down here. There was a 3-day journey to the Red Sea, so you got to see that after 3 days,
right. The
seed right. of vegetation comes on up, you see, as the dry land appeared, you see, it goes into fruition, you see, into the bud state and on the fruition, but the dry land appeared. That was Elohim manifesting as the third day.
Right.
So you got to see the same principle here, you see up here. So when you go down here, you see the seed of Abraham that went down to the land of Egypt, right?
Uh-oh.
And that is, you see, down here for some 400 years. You see, but the seed of vegetation after three days goes into the bud state and fruition. So you see the seed of Abraham after 3 days going through the Red Sea. And the dry land appeared here, the dry land appeared here, and they come out on the other side, or they resurrected on the other side by the third day. And it says there was some 600,350 fighting men, or some 600,000 men, not counting women and children. So therefore, you got to see that when Adam showed up, that is on the sixth day, right, there was no women and children. Isn't that right?
Right.
So therefore, my point is, what you see up here, you got to see down here, because the migration is coming in by way of the creation. And what you don't see here, you see there. Now, I'll say this here, I'm going to move on. We know we have an adversary. Come on, Lucifer. All right? That was in heaven, which we are up here, right?
Right.
So therefore, you got to see an adversary down here. That would be Pharaoh. Mm-hmm. You follow what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
If he's up here, you got to locate him down here. There's a tabernacle in the wilderness, right?
Right.
Why? Because there's a tabernacle up here. Do you see what I'm saying?
Right.
Whatever up here in heaven have to be made manifest. If you don't see it down here, you probably see it up here. And sometimes you don't see it up here, but you see it down here. But once you understand one, you'll understand another, because the principle remains the same, but the manifestation is changing. You with me so far? Now, I kind of deviated a little bit. Now, the point was, it is Yahweh calling Moses up in the mount, blacked him out. That is, on the land or on the earth plane, as he elevates him. The people are at the plateau at the base of the mount. The children, the 70 elders, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and Moses, and Joshua, son of, is on the plateau of the mount. But we read a scripture lesson how today that Yahweh himself, in the personality of Hoshea, the son of Nun, or Joshua, the son of Nun, invited Moses up into the mountain. You see? And he told Moses to come alone and by himself. But if Moses goes up with Joshua to a person who was ignorant of the purpose, then it looked like two people going up in the mountain. What they don't understand is this. Exodus 3 and 6. I ain't got all day. 3 and 6 or the 3 and 7? I think it's 3 and 7.
Exodus 3 and 7.
Read.
And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt.
Read.
And have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters.
Mm-hmm.
For I know their sorrows.
Mm-hmm.
And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians.
Stop. I am come down.
deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians. Now here's Yahweh says, I have come down, and he's talking to Moses at the burning bush. You see, he wasn't coming down below the earth. He was coming down, and listen, he was among the people. He fitting in just like everybody else. Looking just like them. Just as Joshua came in and through the loins of the virgin woman, of the virgin Miriam, looking just like Joseph to Mary's boy. So he's fitting in. So he was hid here, talking about Joshua. Mm-hmm. He had to, Joshua, Oshia the son of Nun, he had to be hid. Somebody said, what do you mean? It was Abraham's seed that came down, right?
Right.
Likewise, those 12 tribes was gathered up around the mountain, right?
Right.
And all of them had names, but none of them had Oshia.
Right.
I'm talking about of Jacob's kids. So there was no tribe that Oshia or Joshua, son of Nun, was belonged to, but he was attached to the tribe of Ephraim. You with me so far? So therefore, if Joshua, son of Nun, was attached to the tribe of Ephraim, when Yahshua Messiah come in, he had to come from the kingship tribe, the lion tribe, from the lion tribe of Judah, which his parents, Joseph, and his mama was attached to. So Yahshua was attached to the lion tribe of Judah. Therefore, you should be able to see that, listen, Judah was the kingship tribe. Y'all with me so far? So he was the king. And of course, Aaron was the brother of Moses, because they set up the Aaronite priesthood or the Levitical priesthood. So Yahshua had to be king and high priest, and that's what he was fulfilling. That is, after the order of Melchizedek, who was king and high priest. So this was a temporary priesthood that Moses set up at the Levitical priesthood. But Yahshua said he come in to set up an everlasting priesthood, that is, after the order of Melchizedek. And Melchizedek, he did have parents just like us, but Moses did not have permission to print who his parents were, you see, because Yahweh is setting up, you see, a type of immortality, that is, with Melchizedek. So therefore, he's king and high priest. So therefore, Yahshua come in, he had to fulfill, of course, the priesthood and also the kingship. That is, King Saul, King David, and Solomon. The kingship tribe had to be fulfilled. Now that we have Yahweh calling Moses up in the mountain, he blacks him out, you see, and then he shows him a rerun of the creation, how it came in by the pattern. And Moses witnessed how that Yahweh, or Joshua son of Nun, you see, transfigured into this glorious body as Yahweh Elohim, you see, being made up of spirit, soul, and body, having a head, chest, and abdominal cavity. I'm talking about him, looking just like a man. But my point is, it was a spirit embodiment of a man. It was not a physical body, but it was a spirit embodiment of a man. But he showed Moses something that appeared physical like a man, mm-hmm, as a reference point, so he can understand the origin of how the creation comes in. So when he, Elohim, comes from behind the veil of inscrutability and incomprehensibility, you see, that's him appearing through the veil as a man. And he communicated with the man Moses within his consciousness. This is a pictorial illustration. Elohim is not over here, and Yahweh, pure spirit, is over here. It's just like you. Moses is having a vision, and we're projecting out what Moses saw. So you can understand that it's all going on within Moses' consciousness. These people that saw Elohim, that was going on within their consciousness. All of these folks, they saw the same thing at the same time. You with me so far? Because the book says, and they saw the God of Elohim, or the God of
Israel.
The Elohim of Israel, or the God of Israel. This is what they saw. You see, and then they begin to describe what he saw. How he had feet, body, and hands. And Moses was caught up a little further, that is, to the top of the mountain. And then he saw how Elohim transformed into this threefold, completely furnished tabernacle, which is the archetype of the original pattern. You see? And he told him and instructed him to build one exactly like the one that he saw on the mount. It had to have a most holy place, a holy place, and a court right above. Because this is an explanation or definition of the shape and form, who is Yahweh, you see, as Elohim. You see, or Yahweh Elohim as the Son. In other words, it is Yahweh who gave birth to the Son, and Moses was a witness to that. Nevertheless, he brings Adam in, that is, on the sixth day. And when he makes the man, he makes him spirit, soul, and body. All right? Now, let's pick that up real quick. Genesis, I think I want 1 and 26.
Genesis 1 and 26. And Elohim said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea.
Just
over
one second, por favor. Because I ain't in a rush. Yet I am. He said, let us make man. I just want to get this Christian thought out of your head. Some folks say that is Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. That is not so. It's just not. Now we can look at this two ways. We know that Joshua's son of Nun was Elohim. Is that correct? Right? And we also know that this was the Holy Spirit that was in Moses, that Yahweh himself put in Moses. And they both went up. Or should I say, it was Moses who was invited up along by himself. That is, by Yahweh himself, who was Oshea the son of Nun. And listen, it's the Holy Spirit in Moses and Elohim in Yahshua, you see, that is going to show Moses how the creation comes in by the pattern. Or it is Yahweh who is male and female. Let us make man in his image and after his likeness. Either one of them. You see what I'm saying? But let us make man what? Read.
And Elohim said.
No. Go back and read what I want you to read. And Elohim, let us make what?
Let us make man in our image.
Yes.
After our likeness.
Read.
And let them have dominion over the
and let them, the male and the female, have dominion. They're kings and queens. Read, please.
Over the fish of the sea.
And listen, the woman was encouraged in Adam at that time. But we don't know that. Let's read.
And over the fowl of the air.
Come on.
And over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth.
In other words, the man have dominion. That's why we got zoos. Zoos, circus, and the man's riding over the elephants, taming the lions. You see, you don't see the lion taming us.
Right.
Having us dance for them and all that kind of stuff. Raise up and you know what I mean? We're not the lions and the cheetahs and the monkey and the monkey's not looking at us in test tubes. You see? Spinning our stuff around in beakers and all that kind of stuff. You get the point? Doing popcorn. They don't have that, they don't have it with me. They don't have the expensive phones. You know, talking about the monkeys.
Yeah.
Looking at us. You follow what I'm saying? They're not doing that. Uh-huh. We're doing that to them. Because we're the kings. So get this thought in your head that we evolved from a gorilla. Or an orangutan, or a cheetah, or whatever it is. You get the point I'm trying to make? Now, so, here he's king. Let's read, please. Come on.
So Elohim created man in his own image.
Uh-huh.
In the image of El created he him.
Read on.
Male and female created he them.
Why? Because Yahweh both masculine and feminine within himself. Now, we're looking for you. You see? Mm-hmm. That's what I'm talking about. We're looking for you. But I'm trying to get you to see your physical body is not the you. The you is the substance, is the essence of the man. The intelligence, the wisdom, the knowledge, the beauty, the love, the justice, the foundation, and the power and strength. The essence of the man, that's Yahweh. You see, this is the thing that's the real essence of you. You see, it's your makeup, your substance, these attributes, which is the, look, they all are beyond the possibility of death. With intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge being the crown. Beauty, love, and justice, you see, I'll say it like this. Intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge give birth to beauty, love, and justice. Beauty, love, and justice give birth to foundation, power, and strength. And these attributes are encouched within the kingdom. You see? Likewise, when you bring in your physical body, you have a head, chest, and abdominal region, but you also have nine systems in your body. And as we have it illustrated right over here, you see, we got the nervous system flanked by the endocrine and, of course, the reproductive system. The respiratory system flanked by the circulatory system and your excretory system, of course, which is your kidneys. You got your digestive tract and you have your muscular and your skeletal system, but is it couched within your skin, which is the 10th organ and the largest organ that is in your physical body. You with me so far? So my point is the man is made in the likeness and the image, that is, of Yahweh Elohim himself. You see, so when Yahweh is presenting himself to the man, you see, in reality, what you must see and what you must understand, that it is Yahweh himself, creator of heaven and earth, who is the parent self, being both masculine and feminine within himself. He gives birth, that is, to his son, Yahweh Elohim. In other words, these attributes of intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, strength took on an organized shape and form as, listen, a spirit embodiment. These attributes make up this body, but it's a spirit embodiment, not a spiritual embodiment. He don't need to know who he is. You need to know who he is.
Right.
He's not trying to be spiritual. He is spirit personified.
Right.
And he's dispensing spirit, that is, to the man so he can understand his makeup and understand his origin. That is him. And right here, as the founder said, he is the whole brass band all by himself, talking about Yahweh Elohim himself, standing, that is, on the earth. So now, you got to see how the Yahweh, who makes up, or he is, personified the angelic host as well as the physical creation. You with me so far? I'm talking about this is Yahweh Elohim right now. Listen, expressed. That is, if you will, the angelic and the physical. So when you come in, this body was formed from the dust of the earth because dust is a type of pure spirit. You see? It had no particular order, scripture, shape, or form, talking about the dust, because Yahweh himself, he had no particular order, scripture, form, descriptive shape, or form. So when he formed the man from the dust of the earth, here he is, right here, being formed from the dust of the earth. Or should I say, virgin Mother Earth. You with me so far? Virgin Mother Earth, that had to be expressed that way, because in fulfillment, when Yahshua Messiah comes in, he had to come through virgin loins. You understand? Why? Because at that particular time, when Adam came in, there was no transgression that had taken place on the earth at that particular time. You see? So therefore, when his mother, when that seed was placed in her, you got to understand, the genetic makeup or the DNA came direct from Yahweh himself. It came direct from the Son, because he, talking about Elohim, he's both masculine and feminine within himself. Why? Because Yahweh himself, he is both masculine and feminine within himself. He does not have to go outside himself to create or to procreate. He's equipped within himself to give birth to his son, which is Yahweh Elohim himself. Consequently, and therefore, he's equipped, talking about Elohim, to give birth to virgin Mother Earth. And as he's moving on the face of the deep, talking about Elohim, this dove is the same as the shape and form. This heart in the same as the shape and form. You see? So therefore, when he takes on shape and form as Elohim, not with Yahweh, but as Elohim, that makes him, Elohim, the archetype, the original pattern of the universe. That's who he is. That's who this man is. Talking about Yahweh himself. He's appearing to the man so he can understand who he is. Talking about you. And we can understand our origin. You see, and what all this is. But my point I'm trying to make is that the entire purpose and plan of Yahweh is encouched within the shape and form. When Yahweh come from behind the veil of inscrutability. But then when he takes up residence in the man, can't you see that the purpose is now encouched within the man? So when you come in, guess what? The Spirit of Yahweh takes up residence in you. Just as the Spirit of Yahweh Elohim took up residence in Adam. Can't you see the purpose and counts within you? So when you get a revelation, it's not you giving yourself a revelation with your arrogance so-and-so.
Right.
You say, it is Yahweh himself who is the boss that give me that revelation. You say, yes. Who you saying that to? You ain't rubbing your own head, patting your own self on the back. You say, thank you, Lord. That's how we say it. Out of ignorance. You say, but when you get in here, we understand it's the flash. Listen, all the Shekinah that's taking place, you see, within your brain here. Because we have a pineal gland, you see, that is responsible for the light in the brain. And when the high priest would perform the service good, or properly, should I say, or correctly, should I say, that is on the Day of Atonement. That flash of the Shekinah, or that light flashes, telling the priest that the service has been performed correctly. You see, and Israel, you see, one more year, they're forgiven for their sin. What are you talking about? When Yahweh stepped out of the cloud, I'm letting you know, their sins was forgiven right here. And we got to go to church, say, you know how he says, the organ started playing, the piano started playing, everybody stand up, and the pastor get up, and say, open the doors to the church. We need your money. Come on in. We open the doors. Come on to God. Come on to God. You know, and we were looking to see who's going to get up. You know, some do, some don't. But for the whole idea, when you come up, you got to get baptized in physical, natural water if you have not. In the meantime, you come fellowship with us, but if you want to be a part of this body, you got to open up the doors of the church, come join, you see, and next thing you know, you be a partaker of the group. Now, you can be an usher, you can be a deacon, you can sing in the choir, but if you don't, if you haven't been baptized, we ain't gonna, you can't sing with the, you can't sing in the choir. Can't be a deacon. Can't be a deaconette. Or a, you understand what I'm saying? Or a sister pastor. You can't do nothing, but you can fellowship with us. Because you're still a lost soul. Mm-hmm. A lost sheep. And Yahshua came to seek and save them which are lost. You see, which is reality, which is us. Now, my point about the door of the church being open, I'm trying to get you to see. You didn't have to go to no church house. Crying, I'll be nice, just crying like a baby, you see, dribblings all over your doggone suit, you see, you follow what I'm saying?
Right.
And saying, I've sinned, I'm a sinner, I'm letting you know, you knew that before, everybody knew that before you walked in, because mm-hmm. So were they, whatever you want to call that, but they think the sin is because they could not keep this law. The sin started right back here with Adam after he transgressed the law. You understand what I'm saying? That's the reality of it. That's the origin of the sin. That's why he said death reigned from Adam and Moses. You see, and sin is not imputed when there is no, where there is no law. You see? Oh man, I could go someplace with that, but I'm not going to be, not, I'm not going to get into that. But anyway, make a long story short, here come Adam being formed from the dust of the earth. And the woman is a couch within him. He is formed from the dust of the earth. The man became a living soul. Alright? And then he was placed in the garden. So he was formed outside the garden. The breath of life came in him. And then he was placed in the garden. Here you come. You're born. You shake the form in your mother's womb for 40 weeks, 280 days, 9 months, or 10 lunar months. Whatever one do you. You take, the shape and form takes place here. That is in the holy place. Now, when the pregnancy is complete, you see, your expected time, I'll say it like this, your effective date, you see, a confinement or your birth, you see, have to come after 9 months. But you have to make a descent. Just as Yahweh made a descent. And as he made a descent, you have to make a descent. And when you make a descent, I'm letting you know that before Yahweh himself took up residence in you, just as he took up residence in Adam, he formed the creation. And when he formed that creation, it was already prepared for the man before he got here. Mm-hmm. He's not going to do no more for you than he did for Adam. He's going to do no more for Adam. He's going to do for you. Mm-hmm. And as the creation was assembled and prepared, when Adam get here, guess what? He had fruit. He had food to eat. And guess what? When you get here, when you coming through those waters, I'm letting you know, you got food to eat.
That's right.
You see, when you show up. You see? And guess what? Just as Adam had parents, you see, which is Yahweh himself, who was the, look, Adam was the first and only created son. You see? And he was an earthen vessel. And we all came out from his loins. What do you mean? That makes him the father of all living. It makes Eve the mother of all living. And she too have an earthen vessel. So, and when if Adam came in from Virgin Mother Earth, then when Miriam comes along, which ain't that time, which was placed on 27, you see, he had to come through virgin loins, and at that particular time, there had been no sin. She had been with no man. That means her body or her temple had not yet been defiled. You with me so far? So when he comes in, you got to see Adam without fault. Holy and innocent. But that was Yahweh made manifest. That, get that understood. That was Yahweh taking a resident or a purpose is now encouched within the man. And as he's bringing the purpose down, Adam, look. It was Yahweh, I'll say it like this. This was the kingdom now on earth. It's that simple. The kingdom on earth. And let me just get this straight and get this understood. The kingdom is not down here. He's the kingdom. Mm-hmm. That's the reality. And therefore, if he's the kingdom, he's establishing kingdoms on earth. Mm-hmm. You see? And so if he's the kingdom, can't you see there's an animal kingdom and there's a vegetable kingdom? But he made him, talking about Adam, king of kings, gave him dominion. You see, all those things in the earth. Why? Because Yahweh himself was the king of kings. And if you got kingdoms, you got to have a king. That's Adam. It's really just that simple. Now, we got him coming on down. And the woman is encouraged within him. Let's read, please. Back in Genesis, where you left off.
And 28, and Elohim blessed them, and Elohim said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth and subdue it.
Now hold it right there. It says, and Elohim blessed them. Right? And where you get off, call yourself trying to bless the food.
Okay.
Call yourself being all holy and pious. Well, we're giving thanks. Yahweh already knew what you need before you got here. That's why he prepared it for Adam when he got here. And he prepared the same thing for you when you got here. And when you really understand, the whole airplane is a type of the Garden of Eden. You see? And when you come in, you're going to come in the same way Adam come in. He come in all his glories. He ain't got no Fruit of the Looms, no Pampers, and no Huggies. You see? He come in all his glory, and you're going to come in the same way. The Spirit takes up residence in Adam, takes up residence in you. You start breathing. However, you're not conscious of who you are. Talk about you. Because death reigns from Adam to Moses. And let me tell you something. When Adam died, psychologically and spiritually, so that is in the dark. It was him who had to bring the purpose down. And as he's bringing the purpose down, the book said, death reigned from Adam to Moses. In other words, he was psychologically and spiritually dead. What do you mean by that? He wasn't physically dead, right? But the state that he was in, that no longer existed with him. He could not communicate with Yahweh when he the same way he did when the sun was in the zenith. Do you understand what I'm saying? When the sun, this ain't going to show it here. When the sun was in the zenith, you follow me? I'm talking about here. He was just told to keep the garden. Just to dress the garden. That's all he had to do. Christianity says, well, you know, the man went, you know, would disobey God. All he had to keep just one law. Now anybody keep one law. I'm gonna tell you right now, I'm gonna tell you something. I ain't missing no meals. You hear me right now? And believe me, there's stuff I say I don't want to eat. Next thing, 2 days later, I'm eating it and feeling guilty. And I eat it again. You get the point. It's not like that. You're going to do things you don't want to do because you got the I can't help it. Oh, man, I can go someplace with this. But to make the long story short, What happened to Adam? You see, Yahweh set him up to bring the purpose down. Meaning this, the man had to fall. He had no choice but to fall because Yahweh set him up to fall. Somebody said, why don't Yahweh do same thing like do something like that so you can come here? Even the angels desired to know the perfect plan of Yahweh. Peter, searching what? Or what? Where's that at? Peter, 2 Peter, 1 Peter. Is it 2 and 5? Searching what? Real quick, I think it's 2 and 5. 2 Peter. First Peter 1:11. Now here's Peter looking back. All right, this is what he said. Read.
Searching what? Of what manner of time the Spirit of the Messiah, which was in them, did signify.
Read, please.
When it testified beforehand the suffering of the Messiah and the glory that should follow.
Read.
Unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us, they did minister the things which are now reported unto you.
Read.
By them that have preached the glad tidings unto you,
the
Holy Spirit.
Now watch this, read on.
Sent down from heaven.
Read.
Which things the angels desired to look into.
What am I trying to say? They too needed a Savior. The angels needed a Savior too. You see? And then folks going to have their audacity and say, what was it? All the angels sinned. What was it? How is it? Yeah. Except Michael and Gabriel. Is that right?
Something like that.
At that time. Oh, even Michael and Gabriel. Yeah,
that too.
Yeah, even Michael and Gabriel. All the angels sinned. Even Michael and Gabriel. However, Michael needed a Savior. Gabriel needed a Savior. All of them. However, the point is, all of them, there were some angels that followed Lucifer out of heaven. And there were some angels that remained. You see, they needed a Savior. However, the point I'm trying to make is that all the angels did not follow Lucifer.
They didn't sin.
You see, I'll say it like that. When they sinned, they instantaneously died. As the founder said, it was as if they did not exist. But then those angels who has come down and gotten to these bodies because they too desire to know the purpose plan of Yahweh. Now, head back.
The Genesis?
Please.
And have dominion.
I gotta push a little bit. Go ahead and read on.
Have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air.
Read.
And over every living thing that moveth upon
Read.
The earth.
Go ahead.
And Elohim said, behold, I have given you every herb-bearing seed which is upon the face of all the earth.
Read.
And every tree in the which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed.
Read.
To you it shall be for meat.
Read.
And to every beast of the earth and to every fowl of the air.
Read.
And to everything that creepeth upon the earth wherein there is life.
Read.
I have given every green herb for meat.
Hence
it was so.
Read.
And Elohim saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good.
It was very good. And at that time, even Lucifer was created. And listen, he too was very good for what he was purposed to do, and that was to pose and deceive. He was good at it. Still is. Read, please.
And the evening and the morning were the sixth day.
Now, jump over to the fourth verse. First chapter, second, 2 and 4. First, I think it's 2 and 7, King James. And 2 and 4, holy name.
2 and 7. And Yahweh Elohim formed man of the dust of the ground.
So he formed the man from the dust of the ground. Read on.
And breathed into his nostrils the breath of life.
Go ahead.
And man became a living soul.
He became a living soul. Here we go.
And Yahweh Elohim planted a garden eastward in Eden. And there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground made Yahweh Elohim to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life also in the midst of the garden. And the tree of knowledge of good and evil.
So he placed him in the garden. Okay, in the midst of the garden. Keep reading, please.
And a river went out of Eden to water.
Jump down
the
to 13.
13. And the name of the second river is Gihon.
17 for you.
17. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil.
The tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Read on.
Thou shalt not eat of it.
Read.
For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die.
Read. Now he told him the day that he partake of the fruit, he will surely die.
And Yahweh Elohim
said. Now let's get this straight. It wasn't a peach. It wasn't a strawberry. It wasn't a grape. And it wasn't no apple that folks want to beat you in the head about. It was an olive. We ain't got time. But an olive has oil. And what that oil did, it anointed Adam to bring the purpose down and to operate the flesh. That's all it did. Nothing more than that. Let's read, please.
And Yahweh Elohim said,
read.
It is not good that man should be alone.
Read.
I will make him a help meet for him.
Uh-huh.
And out of the ground, Yahweh Elohim formed every beast
now,
of the field.
It would be nice. See, it would be true if Adam hooked up with an orangutan or a cheetah or a gorilla. You follow what I'm saying? Or a baboon. Then it might be true that we evolved from. You follow what I'm saying? An ape. But that didn't happen. He couldn't find an old woman or no species that was suitable. Like your book says, help me. Right? King James says, help me. The word meet means that was fit for the man. So Yahweh had to do what? He had to reach, put the man back into a deep sleep. Alright? Because the woman was already in couch with Adam, but you can't see him here. But in reality, Adam had a womb. W-O-M-B. And she became, when she was drawn out, a womb man or a woe man. However you want it. Here she is. So he puts him in a deep sleep. The woman is baptized or encouched within him. We got the principle of burial. The sleep is likened to a death. Come on, folks. Y'all know y'all sleeping at night. You have no idea. You see, you're not dead until you wake up.
Right.
And you say, I had good sleep. Yeah, because you're dead. It's a type of death. That's the point I'm trying to make. And when you wake up, guess what? You don't take your leg and move it, right? You move your head, right? Because all dictates have to come from the head. You see, and when you get up, that's one more time. Listen, Yahweh taking you from, oh, there's so much, from the natural, from the physical state and condition into the incorporeal state and condition. And then you fall right within the gap whereby you is as you don't exist. You don't feel your bed. You don't feel your body. It is, oh man, that sleep is so good. Because it's a type of death. And during that time, you are doing what? You are regenerating. As you regenerate, you see, you wake up, then you degenerate. Likewise, at Yahweh, is the generator. So he brings this thing in. We got it right over here on the jar. He's the generator. But when the man wakes up, guess what? He has to bring the purpose down. He has to degenerate. So the man's in darkness. As he's walking all the way down through the ages of dispensation. But it takes the regenerator, which is Yahshua himself. But Yahshua Messiah himself to do what? To wake him up. To bring him out of that darkness. And nobody wakes you up but Yahweh himself.
That's right.
And please, with your arrogant self, not you.
That's right.
Talking about Jeremy, you and Yahweh. What's wrong with you? Crazy? Because you don't understand, because you think it's you really believe that you are more than what you think you are. But the reality, you are Yahweh in the personality of whoever you are, carrying out the will of the Father, just like he did in the beginning. And you're gonna have the same process coming in with you as it came in with Adam. Now, let's read. I gotta move now. I'm backed up.
And Yahweh Elohim caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam.
Here we go.
And
okay.
He slept. And he took one of his ribs,
uh-huh,
and closed up the flesh and stiff thereof.
Go ahead.
And the rib which Yahweh Elohim had taken from man made he a woman.
Read.
And brought her unto the man.
There she is.
And Adam said.
So he presents his bride to the man that he drew within him. Now, he could have went to the dust of earth and drew her out, right? But he went within the man and drew her out. Talking about the woman. Because if he did that, he would show forth another source. So therefore, he showed the oneness of Yahweh in that the woman was inundated in the man. You see? And the man was inundated in the earth, and the earth was inundated in the waters. and the waters, or the earth was inundated in Yahweh Elohim, and Yahweh Elohim was immersed and inundated, that is, in the cloud. That's the fulfillment. So when Yahshua fulfilled baptism, or the immersion, he fulfilled all of those washings and all of those burials. Even the burial or the waters back here with the flood. You see, and any other washings and burials you can come up, when he got baptized by physical water, he fulfilled every last one of them at that time. All right? Because what he's doing, he's taking the flesh off. As he's fulfilling, he's bringing it to an end. Mm-hmm. Just believe on me and get me in you, and I'll be in you. Don't worry about all those washings. I took care of that for you. So when you go and you get baptized, you think you're doing Yahweh a favor. But what you're doing, you're slapping him in the face, because you're saying that his baptism was not good enough for you. And then we justify it. We'll say it's an outward expression of an inward grace. That's what we say. So we go and get baptized. And come up, and we're just feeling mighty good before the congregation, but you know good and well you are condemned like you was last week when you did whatever you did. I ain't gonna get graphic, but I can, but you get the point. You see? Right? You don't feel, you still have a condemned conscience. And I'm gonna tell you how I know. Even the high priest, when he officiated in the tabernacle, he had to offer up sins for who first? For who first? Himself first. How you gonna clean everybody else up when you feel me? So he had to offer air for himself, air for the people, and then for the cleansing of the sanctuary, and then they can move forward. You see? And they can move forward because the flash of the Shekinah took place. You with me so far? Just as he appeared within the cloud, that veil, he come from behind the veil of inscrutability, and that is the light, you see, that shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended not. That's why you run around talking about me and Yahweh. That's why he created the man last, because he know he gonna say, you know, me and Yahweh, we put this thing together. What was creation in, get all these animals, birds flying and carrying on, you know what I mean? You know, that's how we are. That's just what we do. Want some kind of credit for it. Anyway, read please. Edit that out. Read.
Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother,
read,
and shall cleave unto his wife,
uh-huh,
and they shall be one flesh.
Now look. At this particular time, there had been no sin committed on the earth at that time. There was no Mosaic law. There was no Mosaic law. How I know? Moses wasn't born yet. Abraham, it was not born yet. So there had been no sin committed. And sin is a transgression of the law. Now there was no one law that Yahweh gave Adam. Maybe it was a couple. But technically there was one. Where it says, be fruitful and multiply, right? He told a man to be fruitful and multiply, right? Now, we got to get this out real quick. Fifth chapter of Genesis, let's read quickly. Now, let's get this understood. Adam was Yahweh Elohim in a body, or was Yahweh Elohim as Adam? Now watch, let's read.
This is the book of the generation of Adam.
Read.
In the day that Elohim created man.
Hold
in
it.
Likeness.
Hold it. Hold. Not in the days, right? In the day. Come on, folks. In the day of eternity. It's right here on your chart. You see Genesis 2:4? Right here? It's in the day. And that is the day of eternity. Not the sixth day. Do you understand what I'm saying? The day. Remember, we got time, we got prophetic time, which is, I'll do it like this. We got prophetic time, you see, a day for a year. With me so far? We got creative time, you see, one day with Yahweh is 1,000 years, 1,000 years is as one day. So therefore, if Elohim appeared with the cloud, he created creation in 6 days or 6,000 years. Technically, one day with Yahweh, the thousand years is as one day. So this is creative time up there, the 6 days. Because when one day with Yahweh, the thousand years is as one day. And then we have up here, you see, creation abides within Yahweh or eternity. Not outside of Yahweh and not outside of eternity, but abide within Yahweh or eternity. Whatever one do you, you ain't gonna get outside of Yahweh. And if you do, show me. Take me. Show me I can do it too. You see, everything abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. And Paul let the cat out of the bag. Acts 17 and 24. Let's read quickly. Oh man, time is just so short.
Acts.
Now she's rushing me now. Even though
Yahweh, who made the world and all things therein.
Go ahead.
Seeing that he is ruler of heaven and earth, he dwelleth not in temples made with hands.
In other words, the shape and form does not dwell in temples that's made with hands. Now, let's get one thing straight. The temple and the tabernacle, that's Elohim. He's the temple and he's the tabernacle. Does that make sense? We know he transformed to the tabernacle, but he's the temple and he's the tabernacle. They're one and the same.
Right.
So therefore, that's why you talk about you having a temple. And you know, you're like, well, my body, my temple. You don't have a body. It's his body. It's his body. It's his spirit. Now, where do you get yours from? Since you have one. It's all his. You see? Read, please.
Neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything.
Go ahead.
Seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things.
Talking about Yahweh, y'all here, read on.
And hath made of one man all nations of men.
All nations of men, because Adam is the father of what? All living. Read, please.
For to dwell on all the face of the earth.
That's the four corners of the globe. Let's go. Read.
And hath determined the time before appointed.
Read.
And the bounds of their habitation.
In other words, Yahweh, the ultimate source, the substance, the limit, the bounds, the origin, and the essence of all things, including you. Read, please.
That they should seek him.
Read.
If happily they might feel after him.
As the founder said, every man that is on the globe is imbued with a measure of intelligence to want to seek a creator. They may act like they don't believe in something, but when they get sick and down, they say, you know, I've had some Russians say, praise God. Pray for me. I thought you didn't believe in no God. Well, you know, that's what you guys say. Pray for me. I got diabetes. I got this. I mean, I'm hurting. I got to pray for me. You get the point? Read, please.
That they should seek him if happily they feel... might feel after him and find him.
So they're going to seek him because Yahweh put that in you to seek him. Talking about what you can't agree on.
Though he be not far from every one of us.
Wait a minute. What do you mean he ain't far? I look up in the sky. We know the sun is 93 million miles away. We can see it. But we can't look down the street and see 1 mile because of the obstruction. The obstruction you have, please. And I'm telling you, is your corrupt soul. You have a dead, sick soul that needs to be cleansed, and it's going to take the incorruptible, you see, in order to cleanse you. But if you got to understand something, the incorruptible is the one speaking to you. Mm-hmm. You follow what I'm saying? In other words, there is something in you observing you as you observing me. As you process the information, is him in you, know whether you see it or whether you don't. But since the light and the darkness for him, they're the same, you know what? He'll let you keep you bumping your dog on head, bumping your dog on head, bumping your dog on head until you finally see it. And when you see it, the lights come on like that cartoon. Oh,
yeah.
You get the point? And I'm trying to get you to see is that your theories, your concepts, and your opinions, you see, they have a limit. At the end of the day, it's not reality. But the proof is in the pudding. I'll say it like this. The proof of the pudding is in the eating, right? So you got to have proof. Precepts are principles that do not change. They're just simple, basic truth. The eternal principles, these are theories, concepts, and opinions. In other words, we're just not sure about it. We don't know. Maybe, maybe not, whatever. But this is what I believe.
Right.
That's death. Sorry, but that's what it is.
Right.
Let's read, please. I got to move.
For in him we live and move and have our being.
But in him who? Yahweh Elohim. For in him. We live, we move, and we have our being. Read, please.
As some of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring.
Now, where do you come from? We are his offspring. And since we are the offspring of Yahweh Elohim, that ought to tell you who you are. Quickly, and we get out of here because the bell rung. Russian. I'm just kidding with you. Luke 3:38.
Which was the son of Enosh, which was the son of Seth, which was the son of Adam, which was the son of Elohim.
Y'all see the pen?
You put it in there.
Got it in there. In your pocket?
I take them home all the time. But I slip them back in, though.
You're all gone now.
You think? Anyway, ain't got time. Is his hat under? Anyway, it'll show up. Read, please.
Which was the son of Enosh, which was the son of Seth, which was the son of Adam, which was the son of Elohim.
Now listen, I just proved that, right? That Adam, Adam had an origin. And I'm letting you know, Elohim was the son of Adam. Now, I didn't write that. That's in your book.
You said that backwards. That's right. You said it backwards. You said Adam. You said Elohim was the son of Adam.
Adam is the son of Elohim.
Yeah.
Adam is the son of Elohim. That's the point I'm trying to make. Not Elohim is the son of Adam. But Adam is the son of Elohim. My point is, it was Elohim who gave birth or created Adam. And from him, you see, we can go on, but I'm going to say it like this. He is the father of all living. And Eve, I'll say it like this. My point is, I'll put it like this. She's encouched within him. How about that? All right? And she is the mother of all living.
That's well.
What's the point I'm trying to make? Wake up, folks. You're what you're looking for. This is your origin. I wanted you to see and understand the origin of mankind all the way up to this time. I'll say it like this. This hour, this minute, this second, you understand? This, you're Yahweh Elohim. And the personality of whoever you are. And I showed you your origin, where you come from. I also showed you where you are. That is in the last day. Right. And that is when the revelation of Yahshua the Messiah is taking place. That is right now. You being conscious of your very essence, meaning these attributes, which is divine intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, duty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength, being formed in you is a manifestation of the Holy Spirit. It's not some woo, some old minutia, or some made up stuff. This is your origin. Always have been and always will be. Everything you see is nothing more than a manifestation or expression of Yahweh himself. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah.
Thank you for that. That concludes today's lecture. Any announcements?
I'll be gone the next 2 weeks.
Okay, Kennaway Clans will be gone next 2 weeks. Okay, any other announcements? Also, Lloyd Lawless will be gone for how long?
He's not sure.
Dr. Harris is in the hospital.
Oh, yeah, also Dr. Harris is in the hospital. They say this might be the end of him. You know, so.
Didn't say it.
On his deathbed.
He's in hospice.
Wow. Is it
hospice? Oh.
Okay, it was just brought up today.
Let me make a comment.
Yeah, make a comment. Exchange character.
What we want to, we're talking about the business meeting.
is that it's brought up about the business meeting being changed in the afternoon after class for an hour. I don't like having business meetings over an hour. I just think it's more than enough time to do what we're going to do in an hour. We can't accomplish everything in an hour, but I like a meeting to go 1 hour and they're over with. That's just me. 2 hours and a half, 2 hours, we just ain't going to be doing that. 1 hour, that's all we need. You know, we call it, I like to call it what they call do it groups. Whatever we can do in that short period of time. All right, in one group. However, for those, we're going to bring it up again. If everybody's for that, because we want people, you're all invited to our meeting. They're not private meetings, so you know. It's about the class and what you do and what you don't. What you want, what you don't want, what you'd like to see. If there's any complaints or anything you can improve on, we bring that to the board. But it's your class, and you're invited to every meeting. It's not a private meeting for us. Secondly, I want to encourage everybody, we want to try to go to the symposium November 8th, 9th, and 10th in Albuquerque, New Mexico. In 2019, November 2019, it'll be a great function we can all go to collectively as a class. We can go by train, plane, car, whatever, but it's enough time to prepare for it now. I would like to see us all go. You'll have a lot of fun, you'll meet a lot of people, and you'll see what other folks all over the country is preaching, you see, and you'll have a great time. So I want to put that out there. We're going to pass some information out to make sure you guys know about it, but if you prepare now, we'll be set to go. You see, and I'm not sure what all the details is, but Keenaway would provide that information for us. So, another thing, we talked about the business meeting about having a workshop one Sunday out of the month, likened unto Tuesday night. We can ask questions, whatever questions you may have. And I've been thinking about it. I'm all for it up to a point. Because a lot of folks come out on Sunday, and sometimes they don't hear the things that we do on Tuesday nights, but we can at least do it once out of the month on a Sunday. So I'm going to bring this up again, you know, the next couple of weeks, and we'll deal with it at that point. But what I would like to see is that the pamphlets we have, we can take a pamphlet, and we all read that pamphlet when you need to come to class prepared, because we know we're going to have a workshop next Sunday. You follow what I'm saying? And if you have any questions about textbook, any questions about pamphlets, or something you heard somebody said, or something I said, or something Will said, or something you heard, those kind of questions we want you to bring up at a workshop. Or what you thought was true, and you find out it's not true, you want to know why it's not true and why it is true. Just questions, we want to address those, you know. So we'll bring it up again. But anyway, that's all I have for now.
Okay, all the dishes can be had by Dr. Eunice Fraser. She's a treasurer. We have classes here Sundays at 11 to 1, Tuesdays and Thursdays 7:30 to 9:30. South Stanford, Dr. Sauce. And we have a Spanish class every fourth Sunday of the month. Okay, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling, present your fathers and for the presence of his coming.
Succeeding, Jack.
The
glory with exceeding joy.
Only by Elohim, our Savior, the gospel of Messiah, our sovereign, glory is to thee, the man of power, both of all times, now and forever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Okay, that was pretty good.
Oh, we also need.
Speak in the mic, you can't hear me.
Okay, we also need some assistant, what do you call it, guys?
Moderators. We need assistant everything.
Everything. Camera people, all that.
Okay.
Did you say he was in hospital? Okay.
He's in the hospital.
Dr. Gill was in the hospital.
Yeah, Dr. Gill is in the hospital as well. So I think he's in intensive care. So you can, for those, you can contact him as well.
Yeah, you know.
Well,
because it's your reading.
It's swollen around.
Just stop.
What is that?
This is him in Spain.
Who is it?
Dr. Samuel Salas in Spain at the, what's the name?
Yeah, La Sagrada Familia.
Sagrada
Familia.
Last night was.
That's in Russia.
You got it. Yeah, you got it. Yeah, again.
That's in Russia.
You traveling around, right?
Yeah.
The world's greatest building.
I'm reading this book. By Sigmund Freud.
Sigmund Freud.
Something of an illusion.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So I know. It's talking about the Big Bang Theory versus the story of creation. I know. So, but I mean, you guys encouraged me to read all this stuff. Somebody handed it to me. So I'm researching. I'm on a mission. Sam, what are you talking about? I was kind of blown away. I see now why he said not everybody's going to read this book, because not everybody's going to believe. They probably think that he's committing heresy and all sort of kind of stuff he's talking about, I'm sure. Back in the day. But it makes it an interesting read.
Alrighty.